My name is Anna Adamčíková, and religious name was Sister Damiana. For me to come out of the Missionaries of Charity was kind of a wake up, and I was in MCs around 25 years. Slovakia, in my time when I was little, was and is a very Catholic country, and my family especially was also very, very traditional and is traditional and Catholic. And so I grew in this family that was very protective and very going to the church. But at the same time, we lived in the communist regime, and the communist regime was like real communist regime. We were like persecuted, and when I was a teenager, I remember that we were going for mass, and we used to have a choir practice singing, and it was under the ground because there was a kind of a communist spy that were like after us, and if they find out that we were, for example, going to the church, we could not go to the school we wanted, or the people couldn't get out from the work they were working. So we were living in fear, no? It was like a real persecution, and I remember that once we were in the choir practice, and there was a noise from outside, and we have to be in silence and in darkness for some time because we were afraid they will find us out, no? So these conditions, it was very important for me also why I chose this congregation, because the difficulties that I live in the communist regime inspired me also, because there was this kind of a, we wanted to give up for Jesus whatever was difficult. I have chosen this congregation because it attracted me in this way, that there was a kind of a giving up of everything. They were very poor, and also I loved the religious habit that the sisters were having. Like, it was white, I did not like the black habit. And the idea of going far, going for the missions, that was the most important things for me. Bueno, Since I entered with so much enthusiasm and with that idea of sacrificing and offering, and so I entered prepared in some way for these conditions. But yes, the conditions were over my expectation. I was really taken back with so many things in the formation in Poland. I joined in Poland, and from the very beginning, the next day, already we started the religious life in 100%. So we get up 4:40 in the morning, and during the day, I mean, it was very, very surprising for me that we were controlled from 4:40 in the morning till 10 o'clock. I mean, we had no space for ourselves to be by ourselves, maybe in the toilet, but it was like the mistress always knew where we were or what we were doing. So for me, that was very complicated. I was not prepared for that. No, I felt really, but again, no, I mean, you just want to give everything for God. And so whatever they were asking, you just try to give up whatever you want or whatever you think it's natural for you. And just you try to fix yourself in that frame that is Missionaries of Charity, and to be formed in this way. And it was really like a military formation. I was absolutely convinced in this time that it was needed. I mean, I was thinking that it has to be like this, no? It was just part of the training, and also I idealized so much the religious and the Missionaries of Charity, and the point also was that they were always explaining to us that these sacrifices are for Jesus and it is for souls. So there was always like a meaning in these drastic things that they were asking us or we were doing, no? That every sacrifice had a meaning. when I entered, and there was still this kind of a habit that we used to bake the food. We used to go to bake the food for us and for the people we were having in the home, men who were alcoholics and old people. So we used to go for begging, and when I was already postulant, they gave us a sari, they gave us this long habit that I have to learn how to walk, because it was somehow uncomfortable. I did not know how to walk with a skirt and long one. And we used to go to beg with these plastic boxes, and we used to go to the market where the people were selling things that are like without, like it was not shops, but just on the open free place. And with these plastic boxes, the people used to give us the extra things that they couldn't sell. And what happened is that when we were eating, we used to have every day a bread and oil. And these things that we got from the begging were ham. And we were not eating ham every day, only on Sundays. So we used to keep this ham till Sunday. And since we have no refrigerator, yeah, the ham was already not good when we got it. So on the end, it was green. And we have to eat it. We have to eat it because there was this kind of a divine providence. And it was, I mean, till we couldn't swallow it, we were eating it. And I remember that it was very hard for me, you know, that things were spoiled. And when I was eating the ham, for example, and the cheese and the things that were spoiled, it was very difficult. But I was somehow trying to survive. I was trying to not to be ashamed of what I have chosen for my family, like that I want to give up. So very, very often I was like a kind of a really suffering by myself. I had difficulty to walk with this habit for the first time. I had difficulty to eat the food. And many times I remember even sausages. There was no refrigerator, and the sausages we were putting in the cold water to preserve them for some time. But when we were eating them, they were already sour and acid, and all these things. It was so complicated, but I simply wanted to show my family that I manage, and I want to offer it for God. So, for my family, that they will be proud of me, that I could do it, and for Jesus, that somehow was asking for my sacrifices to offer it for souls. This all this difficulty, I somehow took it, and I really suffered in silence. And I remember that I was so anxious with all these things that were not allowing me to be free, that I was just crying. I was crying because there was also this difficulty that we couldn't speak with each other. I mean, they were from the beginning not allowing us to speak our own language. They were not allowing us to speak Polish. We had to speak English from the beginning. So there was not this personal encounter with my companions. And we had to speak about our personal matters only with the mistress. And the mistress was encouraging us to be open book. But for me, I needed like to share in the same level person that was my companion, my sisters, but I couldn't share personal matters. So, and also there was no time to share the personal matters because every minute there was something to do. And even when we used to go for apostolate for outside, we were told we should pray the rosary on the way. And so when we didn't pray the rosary, we have to speak the folds and kiss the floor. So not to feel guilty and not to that we are doing something wrong, we were simply trying to not to speak about personal matters with each other on the way. So there was this, you know, in the missionaries of charity, there is something very strange, or maybe it's very common in all the religions, I don't know. But there is this point that they say that the superior can make a mistake in commanding, but you can never mistake in obeying. So this time, I find the conclusion or find explanation or give the reason for everything difficult in that sentence. And today I see that this sentence is the best thing for manipulating the conscience, because of course if you don't question anything, if you don't see the meaning and you just put the meaning that everything has the sense, you get trapped. And I think that with this sentence, I just did whatever they told me. And that was the excuse for all that one passed through or find difficult or suffered.
Ana da un testimonio que no es una queja personal por haberlo pasado mal en la congregación que eligió, sino que Ana da el testimonio de un fenómeno llamado abuso de conciencia, del cual ella no tiene ninguna responsabilidad. Las víctimas de abuso de conciencia no son culpables de ser víctimas de abuso de conciencia.
In 1997, I was sent to Argentina, and yeah, it was a happy moment. I was sent far from Poland to Argentina. It was like a wow. And I was really full of enthusiasm. And when I came to the house, we were having old people and also the alcoholics who were from the street. It was really beautiful mission. I mean, to work with the people, poor people, it's really great. And I really enjoyed. Only problem was that I need to learn language. I need to speak Spanish. And we had some little time to learn language, but also we were just also in the apostolate. So, and since I was a nurse, my superior put me in charge of this big number of men. And I was with the aspirants, with the candidates, working together. So the problem was also language, that I was speaking little, and being in charge, I needed to handle so many responsibility. So I was like a kind of a trying to find somebody who spoke little English, and I was trying with one man to arrange the apostolate. And beautiful as it was, I think I fall in the hands of a superior that was not so nice for me. And I was thinking that taking vows, my formation or that rigidity was like over, and suddenly I came to the mission that there was no change in the formation, and I think it was even worse, because I don't know, the superior that I had was a very strange woman. I don't know what to say, but she was having some psychological problem, I think. If the sisters disobey her a little, she used to get very, very angry and she couldn't control it. And I remember once I went to the refectory where the sister was there with her speaking, and she was fighting with her on the end, and only she took her clothes and she threw them on the floor. And then in the night she was afraid that this sister will run away, so she locked us in the house and she put the key under the pillow. It was a very strange behavior that I never saw. I mean, it was like a kind of a wow, what she's doing. We used to come back from the apostolate to come home for the toilet, because we go to the toilet in our own home. And she was not happy, because she was always sitting in the house. I don't know what she was doing. And when we used to come home to go to the toilet, she used to scold us, and she used to call us animals. And I really did. We used to go with a fear to go to the toilet, because she was always there and asking us what we were doing there. And I remember in one moment, we had a big house with a big compound, and I used to go out to the gate, and in the gate we have a little opening that we used to see if somebody is waiting there, no, from the poor people. And I remember I was in such a difficult moment with her that I used to look through the hole, and I was imagining that she is a superior who has a responsibility and the power in this place, but there in the road behind this little hole, there was no more power of my superior. And I really wanted to just put my leg, because there was something that I was not feeling free, and I wanted that freedom, and I wanted to go on the street. I just couldn't take it anymore. No, there was this kind of a heaviness over me that she was not allowing us to be human. It was very strange, because she told us to offer up. She told us to give up. She told us to give it for Jesus. And she said that to be saint, it is this. it is just to offer up everything and to sacrifice for souls and to be little flower again. And so you believe me, I hate little flower. I just don't want to hear about little flower, because all the human things that were so difficult and that we want to share, we were always spiritualizing them, and it was simply already difficult to manage the thing, to be with her humanly, and since still we have to offer everything. So, I mean, today I think it's crazy, because you are in that circle that you can be yourself. You are trained and you are thinking and you are willing and you are wanting finally what they want. Because there is no other thing. There is no other relationship. There is no other circle that you can, and other thing that you can't speak with the volunteers. You cannot speak with the priest without permission. So you are closed in between your superior and between your sisters who are in the community, who are in the same position and in the same mess that you are finally.
En el contexto católico, el abuso de conciencia es un tipo de abuso de poder jurídico o espiritual que controla la conciencia de la víctima hasta el punto que el abusador, tomando el lugar de Dios, obstruye o anula la libertad de juicio de la víctima y le impide estar a solas con Dios en su conciencia. Este tipo de abuso es perpetrado por un representante de la Iglesia, que es respaldado por la Iglesia como digno de confianza. Por lo tanto, el abuso de conciencia siempre tiene una dimensión institucional.
But then I was sent to Chile, and in Chile, first of all, I love the country because it's very similar to Slovakia with the mountains. But also, for the first time, I was working with the children who were having neurological problems. And these children were just fantastic. I mean, it was such a beautiful work and so fulfilling, because they were abandoned children, children with disabilities. And they were small, little babies. So they were very vulnerable. So it's very, very, very easy to take care of these kind of children. In this time also, when happened with the Karadima, came a priest to my community, and I was in this time superior. I was in charge of the house and the children, and in charge of community. So after the mass, this priest used to stay, and he used to take breakfast. And I used to ask him about Karadima also, and I think I got proper person, because he started to share about Karadima because he lived with him. And the priest was telling that he was abused spiritually, and he used to share about the spiritual abuse. Now, for me, spiritual abuse was unknown. I did not understand what it means, spiritual abuse and abuse of conscience. And then I used to ask him, and he used to share all the story with the man, with the Karadima. And finally, he said that he ran away from him. I mean, he asked to be changed to another parish. And then he said, but in what consists this difficulty? And he used to tell that Karadima, on the end, Karadima was asking the smallest little intimate things of life with whom he was, I mean, having a spiritual guidance. And he used to tell, you know, we have to tell him everything. We have to tell him what clothes we bought, when we used to go to the family, when we used to go for the vacation, with whom we were speaking. We used to, and I was looking at him and I used to, but it's normal. I mean, he is a superior. I mean, he should be knowing, no? And I said, but how can this be an abuse, no? And then he started to explain to me about this fuero interno, about the conscience and the freedom on conscience, and about the abuse of conscience, and where the superior cannot completely take the place of God, and where you have to be alone with God. And I mean, the priest helped me to know where to or where to see the barriers, where is the spiritual abuse and where is the conscience, no? Where the superior should not enter. And that was something for me very new, and I used to start to be very sensitive.
Ana habló de un aspecto que a mí me parece muy relevante, que es la idea de la obediencia. Y la obediencia como una forma de llegar a la santidad, unido al lugar del superior, suplantando la voz de Dios. Estos tres anclajes son tremendamente dañinos. Estamos hablando de una congregación donde no hay un abusador con un trastorno psiquiátrico, como es el caso de Karadima, del caso Karadima, en que tenemos un abusador perverso, una persona que tiene la intención de dominar al otro para su bien personal. En este caso, lo complicado es que hay una cultura, y una cultura son creencias, son acciones ligadas a esas creencias, y ahí es donde se encuentra el problema.
And I remember a story of one sister who was with me in Argentina with a superior who was very difficult, and she was very dear to me, and she was there in Calcutta, and she told me story that was for her very complicated because of conscience. And she told me, you know, they put me in charge of a novice who took the medicine because she was having difficulty with her mistress. We don't know her intention, but she simply went in coma. And since I am nurse, the general told me to take care of her. And, you know, I was there with her, and I told the general, you know, this little one is in coma. I don't know what medicine she took. And I am having a fear that she could go away. I mean, we have to take her to hospital to clean her stomach and to be sure that it is out, because the medicine could act and she can pass away. And the general told her not to do it. She told her to trust in God and to stay with her, accompany her, and to pray that it will not happen, that she will go away and she will survive. And she didn't want to take her to hospital. Then I was telling her, but why she didn't want to take her to hospital? And she told, I really don't know. Maybe she didn't want to make a case. It was just time to for the mothers to be canonized. And I told her, but she could die. And then she said, that's my problem. I did not know. She wanted to stay, that I will stay there, but this child could die there. And we were risking her life. And we didn't want to take her to hospital only because it was going to be scandal. And then there was another thing that really was like a bomb for me, because a sister died, and we always get a letter when the sister died, and they send us a letter from Calcutta about her life, about what happened to her and when she died and all these things. And then after some time we got the news, not from our sisters, but from the bishops of Calcutta, that told the story about our sister to another sisters, and it came to our sisters. Simply, she took her life. She hung herself on a sar in the toilet. And when I heard this, again, maybe when I got sick, I did not feel so much pain, but I feel so much pain for my sisters. And she went this way. She died this way. What the anxiety she must be having if she hung herself on a sar in the toilet. She hid herself to suicide because we don't have place even to die, I think. And she suicided in the toilet hidingly, and they didn't tell us the truth. And we have to come to know the news from another sisters, from another congregations. So I went to the regional and I told her, sister, what is this? Why you don't tell us the truth? That is the minimum that you can tell us. If they don't take care and they don't want to solve the problem and look at the problems of the communities, why they don't tell us the truth on the end? And she told me such a stupid answer that I was thinking. She told me, what, you want to tell the truth in the paper, in the letter? You want that the other sisters will do the same? Wow. I mean this answer is absolutely incompatible with the reality. I mean, this sister is not okay because one sister took her life because there was difficulty and we hide her ending because we don't want that the others will imitate her. So I was thinking how many truths they hide, how many sisters maybe died and we don't know, how many difficulties are there we don't know, how many painful stories are there and we don't know. And it's painful, and I think it should not just pass like a, I mean, we cannot, okay, we hide the things because of the people outside don't know, but we hide to each other, so it means there is a big problem. There is a big abuse that we don't want, that we, even to each other, that we know about this, no? I couldn't do it anymore, and I told her I'm going. I asked for a year of discernment, and I just couldn't pass these things like it is nothing happened, no? Because finally, this priest made me sensible to this abuse, and my conscience was already like a shouting in me, no? That this is not okay. This is not okay. This is not for God. This is something they are doing. That's something that is not from God. Finally, I after 3 months, I got a letter that I could go. So I was preparing my things and I wanted to go for my discernment. And the sister still told me, I said, "Sister, I am going." And she told me, "Oh, Damiana, you are looking for yourself. You are going because you got tired of offering and for giving up for Jesus, and you are running away from the cross. And you promise to be faithful, and you are running from the difficulties." I can tell you that if I would not have this priest's words that this is the abuse, I would also not be able to go. I needed someone outside to support me with the knowing how the abuse is working, that they will tell me exactly these things, what they tell me, that I'm running away from the cross, for me to feel guilty. So I knew that I will hear these things, so I just told, no, I am not running away from the cross. I am right there on the cross. I just cannot, you know, my conscience for me, it was something that I always try that they will not take it away, even though it was difficult, but that conscience that I struggled when I was in communist regime, that I always try to fight and try to go against difficulty, even they were like in the communist regime was difficult. I always felt that I have to fight for the truth. And so when I found the truth, I couldn't stay anymore. There was something that I simply couldn't see the things and not to do anything and to stay, because I felt like I'm part of something that is not okay. So I said, I'm going, and I was going. I was preparing my things, and yeah, for me to leave the sari, that sari, that habit that I was always proud of, it was something that was identifying me, something that was part of me for 25 years, and I was crushed by taking it off. I was feeling like I'm taking away my skin, really. And I had difficulty. I was out. I was without sari, and I have to go for therapy because I couldn't make it. I was feeling like naked. I was feeling like I lost identity. And the worst thing was, I really did not know how it affects when you come out after so many years. I remember a moment. It was very strong that I was in Santiago in metro, and there was a part of one station that is very, very deep, very. And I was there in one moment where there were so many people crossing, going from one side to the other. And I was there, and suddenly I saw there was a crowd going. There were so many people coming, and I looked back, and there were so many people going from behind me. And And I had no habit. Now, before, with the habit, I was always representing Missionaries of Charity, and I was always at a point when the people were looking at me. But this time, I was not having habit, and I realized that nobody was looking at me. So when I realized they were not looking at me, I thought, they don't see me. And I felt that they don't see me because suddenly I did not feel I am real, you know? I felt like I'm transparent, that I have no body because I had no habit, and I felt they would smash me. I felt they did not see me, and there were so many coming, and I was not used to go on the metro, and that I closed my eyes because I couldn't do it. I was so scared. I got like a phobia. I was thinking they will smash me because they did not see me. And then suddenly I went to the wall and I was kind of touching the wall, and I was trying to realize that I had no identity. I did not exist. And then I slowly like I tried to come back, and I remember this point when the mistress told me that you are without head and you are no more you. And then I realized that it was true. I was no more there. I there was nothing of me left. But I never felt it before, only when I gave up my habit and I was alone and I needed to just to put back my corporality, to be Anna again and not a sister, and I came out from the background down and come up, and I started to slowly to connect myself again, you know, again. I look for my head to be back myself, but I try to recover Jesus back, Jesus that gave us life and wants to give me life and loves me the way I am and to be happy, no? I don't know, to be free. Thank you.